Greetings, everyone. I'm Julie. I'm here to give the non-introduction. First to logistics. The Southampton Review submissions, we're accepting them until November 1st, so get your submissions in. And just a heads up, 2 weeks from now, on October 19th, Betsy Carter will be here as the next installment in the Writer Speak series. But let's focus our attention on tonight. So tonight's guest, I could have talked about his professional accomplishments. He's the director of the Creative Writing MFA at the New School and an active force in the world of poetry and beyond, also nonfiction and fiction indirectly, I think. You don't write fiction, right? No, never touched the stuff. I could talk about it, his scholarship. He's got an interest in crime novels and noir. He's written a biography of Jim Thompson. He's edited a couple of anthologies of crime fiction. But he's also edited, he's written a scholarly book about James Merrill. So he has a breadth of scholarship that he brings to the table. And I could talk about his restless aesthetic as a poet, his active imagination, and how he's, in his latest book, Hollywood and God, is mixing poetry that looks like poetry on the page with prose. We've been talking in my poetry workshop about principles of collage, and you'll hear that happening tonight with him. Even the title of the book, Hollywood and God, is mixing two words that we don't necessarily connect. And the very fact that he brought a movie to his poetry reading, I think, says something about the breadth of his intellect. But I'm not going to mention any of that, because I just want to say, when I first heard Robert Polito get up and read, I thought, oh my God, you can be a poet and be dashing. So here is Robert Polito.
Thank you, Julie. That was so sweet. It's really a pleasure to be here in Southampton, and it's I want to thank Julie and Susie for inviting me and for being such incredibly good hosts. I'm going to start by reading from Hollywood and God, and then move backwards, and then show the movie, and then end up reading a little bit after the movie. It's a very short movie. Hollywood and God. Is the title sort of hints at. It tracks where the American search for transcendence out of the 18th and 19th century, like Cotton Mather comes up a little bit in the book, but it tracks where that bumps up against celebrity culture in the 90s and in the 21st century. And I'm going to begin by reading the title poem. It comes late in the book, but I think it anchors a lot of things that are around it. Hollywood and God. If only God would save me, I would know how to hurt you. If only God would save me, I would know who to sell my soul to. Anything is an autobiography, but this is a conversation. William Burroughs insisted literature lagged 50 years behind painting, thinking, no doubt, about abstraction, collage, fragmentation, his cut-ups. But whatever that meant, why always 50 years? Or however he presumed to rile other writers, poetry probably does lag behind any credible media theory about it. So that if I put a pine tree into a poem, a grove of pine trees, and beyond them the sea, you'd think it was the same tree Wordsworth put there. Instead of two obligatory centuries of nature studies, all those technicolor vistas, tort songs, couples drifting through leaves and Salem commercials. Into one life and out another, the way a junkie playing a writer playing a priest, so that when I finally blurted out, you betrayed me, I wounded you, we're so unhappy, you assumed the burden of personal urgency, Supposed it was me speaking at the limits of my self-control and not the damn don't cry temptation and leave her to heaven. You open your mouth and a tradition dribbles out. But that's mimesis. How almost impossible to avoid mimesis. Anybody's hardest truths prompting the most fractured constructions. The way to think about God might be to disobey God, if only God's wish to remain hidden. So that if everything is an autobiography, this is a conversion. As my lives flash before me, why must the yearning for God trump all other yearnings? You often hear converts confess the drinking, his pills, her sexual addiction, concealed inside them a yearning for God. But why not the other way around? The admission of Jesus into your life, concealing instead the wish, say a need, to be fucked senseless, drunk, drugged, and screaming, oh God, on a hotel bed. God embraces our yearnings. That afternoon, my father heard his diagnosis of an operable cancer. My Aunt Barbara demanded we get him to Lourdes. She demanded this with a glass of vodka in her hand. She demanded this, running her fingers up and down my leg. She demanded this before she passed out in her car. In the movie of my life, my father died after I forgave him. And when my secret tormentor said, may the ghosts of your dreams gnaw at your belly like a wolf under your jacket, did she really want revenge, or was she just killing time? For me, God is a hair shirt, or he's nothing. For me, God is a pain in the ass. That's mimesis again. This hour, I tell you things in confidence. I might not tell everybody, but I'll tell you. The world is a road under the wall to the church. The world is a church, and the world is a road, and the world is a stone wall. Still, he wanted her the way the cardinal wanted the Caravaggio. And when the ill-advised possessor of the painting resisted, one night papal guards searched his house. Of course, contraband came to light, some illegal rifles. And when the ill-advised possessor of the painting went to prison, the cardinal got his Caravaggio. But I wasn't a cardinal, nephew to the Pope. And you were not a Caravaggio. So I asked you to be in my movie. This next poem is called Two or Three Dreams, and it's in two parts. It derives a title loosely from Jean-Luc Godard, and each of the sections is titled after something else. Like the first section is called Detour, and it's titled after the great Edgar Ulmer B movie of the same name, and the second is titled Grendel's Mother after an episode in Beowulf, and it quotes a little bit from Seamus Heaney's translation of Beowulf. Two or three dreams about. One, Detour. A rented house, rainy season, behind the green wood-paneled wall, first only on storm nights, then every night. Our family of skunks tries and fails to lift again, the door into the crawl space. Door banging down on its hinges, each time they fail. My mother breaks the darkness, arriving in the night. Forgive me if I sound theatrical, I hear her say, but your brother will try to kill himself, then try to kill himself again. That's once for each time he watched me take too many pills and wouldn't telephone you or your sister. Inside the crawl space, the skunks screech and mate, send their secretions through the heating system. My mother, during her final illness, filled any gap with the word phlegm. I was eating my phlegm and when the nurse came in to take my phlegm. Please take care of your phlegm. He'll need you now that I'm phlegm. Bold behind glass, the cats hiss at the skunks. For all our banging, shouting, nothing. Still they lift the door and crowd in. Where did you leave his body? Vera surprises Al Roberts and Edgar Ulmer's detour. This buggy belonged to a fellow named Haskell. As the cats scratch at the heating grates, stretch a claw down to the crawl space. Two, Grendel's mother. My father's earliest memory is not the icebox overturning onto him, but his mother lifting it off. That was right before she fled alone to New York City. He told us instead that she died. The Beowulf poet remembered Grendel's mother as mournful and ravenous. In my father's dream, his father is Grendel's mother. Not as once upon a time he feared, a bully backhanding his wife after she cracked a glass of their wedding crystal. A drunk relieving himself on the kitchen floor. But only a creature in a book. He dreams the disenchantment of the world, not monster, but paper, ink, bottle, father. The next poem is called Mike the Winger, and Mike is one of these kind of recurrent artist figures in the book, and he's kind of a iconic, maybe even ironic figure of transcendence. And the city that's mentioned near the beginning is Quincy, Massachusetts, where I mostly grew up. Mike the Winger. City of Presidents, City of the Granite Railway and Four River Shipyard, but City, too, of condoms ground into our pitcher's rubber, and City of water rats and black leeches floating in the spring runoff. City of the first Howard Johnsons, the first Dunkin' Donuts, City of Lee Remick modeling summer dresses for her father's store, and City now where Beatles albums drop from the sky as Mike the Winger speaks from inside a circling crowd. Pockmarked, pimpled, and blazing, he looks, Tommy LeBlanc said, like someone set his face on fire and then stomped it out with golf shoes. As he straddles his new black Phantom, as he rocks on his new red Keds, as he pounds his wire basket of new LPs, Mike demonstrates the legendary gesture that gave him his name. I play him once, then I wing him, he says. Every afternoon, Mike spins his own top 40 from his bike, like a paperboy launching the Patriot Ledger across our lawn. Those Rolling Stones, those Beach Boys, those groups all you kids like, they're okay. But man, I love them Beatles. They wing up real good. What about his parents? Where does he grab all that cash? Nobody stops to ask, caught in the awe of the grandest phenomena. Manna from heaven, records eased from their jackets and arced into air, records pristine and gleaming in trees, records scratched and gritty on the streets. Amid shouts of go Mike, go nuts, go wing nut, come on Mikey baby, wing one over here. The hits just keep on coming. The dead are everywhere, but if Mike is still alive, he'd be tracking retirement age. Though how do you retire from something like winging? Mere technological obsolescence, Mike frustrated by CDs casualty to a digital age. Maybe winging records is like making movies or saying mass, your calling. You do it until you can't do it anymore. Mike worshiped the early gods of rock and roll, Chuck Berry, Elvis, Little Richard, and Buddy Holly. Then he winged everybody else. None of the records Mike tossed have ever gone away. Who would have guessed that? City of John Adams and John Quincy Adams, our second and sixth presidents. City of Miles Connor, rockabilly singer and art thief. City of Robert Polito, City of Mike the Winger. I was giving a reading in Los Angeles, and somebody came up after the reading and said that he knew Mike the Winger, and in fact his parents owned the record store where Mike bought all of his records, and he told me the story of seeing Mike at a George McGovern rally, and Mike want, you know, Mike didn't strike me as kind of your typical liberal or leftist, but he very much wanted McGovern to defeat Nixon because Nixon had done a press conference on TV one night that meant that a show that Mike was devoted to either be postponed to another week. So, politics. I'm going to read an earlier poem called First Love. First Love. The day is too beautiful. The spring sun on the porch too warm. He's restless. Nothing can contain him. Not his books or a whole house full of toys. Not even the hidden fortress he's built deep in his grandmother's garden. For this is his special day. His secret love is coming to have dinner with his parents, with him. Irish, plump, black hair set like a helmet over her red face, an old student of his mother's dead sister, smelling of soap and flowers. He can't wait to see what she's brought him, can't wait for her soft words, her wet kiss. So he decides to meet her car. First, he skips to the corner of the street and waits. A half hour seems to go by, but still no sign of her great black Chrysler. He thinks he knows her route, recalling the day she drove them to her house. And slowly he sets off, one street at a time, stopping at each new corner to look all around. Down the street they take to Mass, with its wall of trim brown three-deckers. Along a wide avenue divided by a strip of land where there are benches and trees. Then he's not so sure where he is anymore. Suddenly, there's what looks like a highway. So he starts walking in the other direction, trying to retrace his steps. But it's all new to him, unfamiliar. He keeps on walking until he's too tired to go on. And humiliated, lonely, he sits down on another porch and begins to cry. He's certain he'll never see his parents again, never see Barbara, when a minister he mistakes for a priest comes out of his house and saves him. He brings him inside, asks his name, and goes to the phone. Returning, he says, they sound like nice people. You know they've been very worried about you. The minister's wife and their two grown daughters make much of him. They sit him in the sun, stop his crying, wash his face, and feed him soda and cake. He can't remember ever being treated so nice. He feels like the young prince in one of his storybooks. But at last, there's her black car. Once again in tears, he runs to them, to Barbara, to his mother and father, telling them over and over that he didn't run away, that he loves them, that all he wanted to do was meet her car. His mother's crying, and Barbara, they hug him and say they're glad to have him back. His father, too. But suddenly, he seems confused. He pulls his son away from the two women and starts to shake him. Do you understand how much trouble you've caused us? Do you know that you walked over 5 miles? That's one for every year of your life. He seems about to hit him. Anger and awe alternate on his face. Just like the time the boy received his first toolbox and went off by himself for an entire afternoon, impatiently, methodically, sawed the railing off the back porch. His father furious, but amazed that he could do that with a toy saw. Anger and awe crisscrossing his face like crosshatching. Are those cheap prints where the rabbit becomes a duck and the beautiful girl turns into a skull grinning from ear to ear? His awe equal to his anger, so that in the end, he's unable to strike. This is another semi-autobiographical poem called Doubles. I have a bit of a cold, so I just have to keep watering. Doubles. I fancy myself an enigma. On my best days, I manage to keep the world off guard. What I say does not follow from what I said yesterday. Or the message in my clothes is somehow inconsistent with my face. A banker's striped suit under shades and a flashy pompadour. Around me, people must continually readjust. I force them always to approach me on my own terms. Only I keep changing those terms, keep shifting ground. Around me, the angle of incidence does not equal the angle of reflection. It's not that I have any secrets or a secret life. If anything, my life's what's left in the shell after the clam's been eaten. So I arrange to have many lives, many stories, all of them plausible, taken one by one, but not quite adding up. It's a lot of work, but the looks I get, the odd questions I'm asked, would repay any trouble. Sometimes when I'm very tired, I think, how nice it must be just to trot out this year's model and keep him there. But then I remember what I've gained, to be all men at once, without being anyone. And I recall the danger, too. Staying put is like asking the world to do you in. But these aren't real issues anymore. All problems stopped right after my order was delivered from the Institute, two huge bundles wrapped tight in black paper and cold to touch. My contact had insisted one to a customer, but I cheated a bit. Claimed I was twins, identical twins, so we sent a pair. Unpacked, released from their tubs of dry ice, even as they stood frozen and immobile, I could see they were marvels. Whole, self-sustaining universes of cells spun from two of mine, my equals down to the last hair and birthmark. And thawed, breathing freely, they lacked only a history. Such details are absorbed more easily than you'd think. Like me, they're fast studies. Hardly a week of pleasantly intense afternoons goes by, and provided with the necessary names, a few photographs, some not entirely congruent facts, and the basic rules of presentation, they seem more emphatically me than I've ever felt. I have great plans for us. One I'm coaching soon, so that soon he'll be a star. Every night in clubs he gets applause for singing my songs. When the smack begins to flow, then I really don't care anymore. Or, every time I phone you, I just want to put you down. Exhilarating words, so angry and bitter, I'd be afraid to say them in real life. The others just received a second promotion at the bank. And there's talk he'll be a vice president before he's 40. But I don't have to do anything. I can read all night, listen to records, or drink without worrying whether I'll be able to go to work in the morning. It doesn't matter if I get up, or what I eat, or how I look. I'm completely free. No matter what I do, my life goes on without me. Sometimes in disguise, I visit them to check up or keep in touch. And request a song or a loan. They usually indulge me. Has any father ever been this proud? And always I'm amazed at how effortlessly they handle all that I find impossible. Through long, distracting lunches with my mother, they smile and hold their tempers. They remember birthdays, keep appointments, pay bills. I'm never feeling well, but they're healthy, moderate habits, exercise, periodic trips to a doctor. In their hands, my life positively hums. Yes, things are looking up. I sense that everyone is talking about us. Words come back to me that the inevitable double-sighting has taken place. Imagine trying to explain that. And in the paper, I see that one of us has broken off an engagement. That's the spirit. She's not good enough. Hold out for bigger stakes. I joke, for what could make me happier? One of us must settle down soon and start a family. What we have is too rich, too perfect, just to pass away. But I want the last word here, too. When I die, I've asked them to bury me quietly, anonymously, and go on as if nothing's happened. Hollywood God is to a certain extent, it's a book of ghosts, and one of the ghosts is actually my father-in-law, and this is an elegy for him called Pacific Coast Highway, and it's dedicated to Robert Harris. As in the old story, a man keeps crossing the street. The first time, his son is with him, stumbling ahead to the sidewalk behind their Jeep, parked so that they could watch it from the bar. Just ahead, railroad tracks, and beyond, cottages, sand, the great Pacific. But each time the man crosses, he is struck by a black SUV, bounced onto the hood for 80 feet, and rolled another 50 down to the rail bed. His son must be on the other side waiting. Again, the man crosses the street. So we're going to take a little intermission now to look at a short movie. The movie was made by two people, Brent Kite, who is a student at the New School, as well as somebody who writes regularly about movies and has made other movies, essay movies like this himself, and a friend of his named David Phelps. And the poem is called Deep Deuce. And if I were reading the poem now, what I would tell you is that Deep Deuce is the name of a street in Oklahoma City. It's Deep Deuce means way down on Second Street. And it was the street that back in the 20s and 30s, where all the jazz clubs used to be. You can read about Deep Deuce in Ralph Ellison's Invisible Man, or also in some of Ellison's letters that are about jazz and music. But by the time that I saw it, which wasn't that long ago, it was almost totally obliterated. Most of the buildings had been turned down, and there were just a few kind of footprints of where the buildings used to be, and most of it was kind of grass with the occasional foundation. And it mentioned someone named Charlie Christian in it, who's the great jazz guitarist. So this is the film about Deep Deuce, or based on Deep Deuce.
You have to reset it. Okay.
And I'll read two more poems after that.
Ladies and gentlemen, this dance music is coming to you from the Pinnacle Club at 52nd Street and Broadway. This is the playtime spot of the elite.
Come on over and join the merry throng. It's a big night. Let's go, boys.
Robbery. The truck was gray.
One of the suspects has sandy hair, that is all.
Kowalski.
As phantoms direct life from the shadows, I feel I leaned on something.
I feel I leaned on something. And it broke. My father on the porch with his crosswords said, "This must be what it feels like to be dead." When I returned from the dead, there was no one to greet me. But still you are glad. I wander the ruins the way my tongue wanders my missing teeth. The bricks and mortar of deep deuce, rotted like molars in an ancient mouth. Here, Charlie Christian might have walked. The astrologer counseled patience and creative imaging. Step one, visualize an object that symbolizes the accursed influence. Picture yourself throwing it into a furnace. Step two, visualize the person who is responsible for the curse. Imagine one end of a rope is tied around your waist and the other around that person. Picture yourself cutting the rope with a chainsaw as you call out, "You have no power over me." Step three. Repeat twice a day for 11 days. You visualize her green boots inside the furnace. No, you are in a crematorium and you see her perfect and corruptible body on a tray sliding into fire. Then you see yourself cutting the rope that ties you together with a saw. And then, at last, your own imperfect and corruptible body, I mean me, calls out, and I jump in after her.
time rapture we knew. And from that day, nevermore will I say there's no you.
No, all poets should be so lucky to have movies made from their poems. So I'm going to read two more poems. Ghosts inevitably raise the issue of the relationship between the living and the dead, and I've always thought of poetry as, in some sense, a conversation between the living and the dead. And this is a poem called What the Dead Know. Air here is like the water of an aquarium that's been lived in for a while, clear and still beyond the rigors of glass, appearing cold and clear as spring streams fed by snow and ice, but unexpectedly warm to feel and inviting. Side-lit, a vitality of shadows once you come into it, and long bars of light burning like spots, remarkable for the absence of dust in their sharp crossfires. Heavy, as crystal is heavy, as if to move here would mean pushing against a force palpable and strong, yet rich with prospects of life, comfortable with the idea of life, as if, put on its slide, every drop is stocked with wonders, swarming, about to burst. Beautiful, in a way, one element sustaining another, our message brought home so that the living might come to see. Harder to say that without them, we are nothing, water without air, or to speak of our isolation or our special loneliness, or say as they look right through us at their plants, pictures, books, windows, reflections, and blank white walls, that we need them to orient ourselves and to tell us who we are. Or that with each look, they're swimming to within our sights. Or that we are always casting wider and wider. And that even now, they are fighting to avoid our nets. And so the last poem I'm going to read is, it's called Sister Elvis, and it's in four parts. And it's in the voice of a female Elvis impersonator. Sister Elvis. I called myself Sister Elvis until Memphis. I called myself Sister Elvis until the night I came to in a blackout. All my life I wanted to carry Elvis's face into the future, pretend to be filled with the Holy Spirit, everyone said, until you are. As far back as I can remember, it was drizzling, and I was dreaming Memphis in the rain as I wondered what Elvis was doing. The Lord gave Elvis to the world as a gift, but when I sang, you heard his voice. That night in Memphis, there was no moon, so throwing no shadow, I must have risen sick from the motel floor. Somehow, I found my way to the bathroom mirror. I took my car keys and cut and stabbed and cut at what I saw, until Sister Elvis was just a dream and a lie. 2. Are you lonesome tonight? Elvis's body is in Graceland, but his soul is in heaven, and his spirit will always be here with us. One time on the road, Elvis stopped his car and got out. See that cloud, he asked. I'm going to move that cloud. And the cloud moved. Maybe the wind blew it, I don't know. Elvis, I'm told, only looked around and smiled. In this way, his spirit guides me. When I'm on stage, Elvis takes over. Then I become his earthly vessel. Like a priest on Sunday, I'm giving the live performance because God himself can't be there in body. Believe me, it takes a lot to stand before your congregation and pull something like that out of your soul. In high school, the drama coach cast me as an intergalactic female Elvis on a planet ruled by women. The smart fat boy who wrote the music believed he was a girl. Song after song of ancient church music, a slow, glorious drone. Years later, I heard the boy move to San Francisco, raised money enough to change his sex, and came out as a lesbian. I remember thinking that is an awfully roundabout way for anyone to go, just to sleep with girls. But who cared about fucking Elvis? I wanted to be Elvis. 3. Don't look at the guilt, look at the blood. All my men were cheap, but they were quick. My husband spoke little and only of sex and departed in somber haste after his seed was spent. Any Christian, he said, who would allow any type of rock or country recording in her home, she's inviting the powers of darkness. Any individual listening to it, she's entering into communication with wickedness and evil spawned in hell. But God called me from a Sears and Roebuck Gene Autry guitar. You'll take my gospel to the world. The lights and the noise pulling me like a compass. In a gold vest, my long hair slick with brill cream, I ascended the stage of the county fair. I grabbed the mic stand in my left hand, hung my other arm over the guitar neck, tipped back one shiny shoe, and sneered a little laugh I saw him do. Elvis became part of me that day. Someone told me that at the premiere of Love Me Tender, when the character Elvis played was killed, Gladys, Elvis's mother, started to cry. But Elvis put his arm around her, said it was okay. He was right there with her. And on that cruel August morning, I heard Elvis really did die. I was afraid my voice would die too. I knew that if I didn't pick up my guitar right away, he would never sing again. So I prayed, I have sinned against you, my Lord, and I would ask that your precious blood cleanse all stain in the seas of God's forgetfulness. And that morning, God showed me his harvest field. 4. I think what God meant to say was, look at the blood. No more tears, the music, the beat takes over. The audience and I seem to roll with it as one, night after night. Funny how you know what God means, then lose it, then find and lose it all over again. But when did I start to lose my way? But right or wrong, wasn't the Elvis trail my way? I prayed and drank, drank and prayed, trying to make my days cancel my nights canceling my days. Until the night in Memphis, a motel so close to Graceland, coming to in a blackout of vodka and sin, and I beg your forgiveness. What I can only call the awe of it all overcame me. I took my keys and sacrificed the face of Sister Elvis, offered my own face up to him. My blood was everywhere. I keep returning to that night, the rain falling on Memphis, and coming to in a blackout, I cut and stabbed and cut. And when I was done, I looked out the window at the silent cars, the motel signs. There, in the drops of rain and crud on the glass, the unmistakable likeness. Not my slashed face, but his. His perfect cheekbones, forehead, nose looking straight at me, so pretty. And I felt safe, overcome no more. And I went outside to save all I could of his image on a paper napkin. My forever shroud of Memphis. Thank you. Questions are good.
Will you take my question? I think I meant.
Yeah.
So I'm curious in a poem like Hollywood and God, how you invent principles to, you have to invent the collage, and how, what are the principles you forge to make, to know how to build it?
Well, it has little, you know, little triggers kind of built into it in some ways. And but I also can't say that they were fully intentional, but there was this little kind of constellation of energy, you know. So that phrase, like, anything is an autobiography, and it was a quote from Gertrude Stein, but it's from her book Everybody's Autobiography, and I thought, like, in a kind of collective portrait, Everybody's Autobiography is, you know, is kind of the perfect kind of title for it. You know, the William Burroughs stuff is a little bit kind of self-explanatory, that notion of, you know, he's suddenly talking about collage and writing, you know, 50 years behind painting. When I put in the three titles of noir films, I wanted noir films that seemed religious, like The Damned Don't Cry, Temptation, and Lever to Heaven. And then near the end, where their speaker seems to get, like, very confessional, this hour I tell you things in confidence, I might not tell everybody, but I tell you, that's a confessional sentence, but it's a quote from Walt Whitman. It's like, it's Walt Whitman's autobiography, it's, you know, but it, and it's from a poem called Song of Myself, which, you know, which seemed like everybody's autobiography, like a kind of loaded title to kind of use in it. And the story about the Roman cardinal and the Caravaggio was something that I got on the headphones of a tour of a museum in Rome. And it was just that this, you know, this cardinal desperately, you know, wanted this painting, and somebody else had it. And so, you know, he arranged to have, you know, papal guards both search his house but plant stuff there that would send the person to jail. And so it was just this kind of swirl of stuff. And what I was also interested in is that a lot of collage poems, but not all of them, I mean, you're meant to notice the seams, you know, like in the Wasteland or Pounds. And then there's other kinds of collages that you might see in, like, Frank Bedard poems or John Ashbery poems, where, or even Bob Dylan songs, you know, where they're just as heavily collage, but they're meant to sound seamless, you know. And I wanted, what I was always going for was kind, or most of the time going for, was a kind of seamlessness, that it would look like one person talking, even though that person was kind of unimaginable by the end of it. And the reason why that poem comes late in the book is that I sort of imagine that at that point it's almost the book talking, you know, it's the book Hollywood and God talking about what it's doing in the other poems.
Yeah.
Make any sense?
Totally.
Okay.
To me.
How, I love this film. How did it come about? Did you write a screenplay for it, or do you have a friend who was like?
Well, yeah. No, it's no screenplay. I mean, what you heard me read was just the poem, you know, as it appears in the book. And I was talking to Brent one day, and I had seen, even before he came to the New School, some films that he had made, the collage, Orson Welles films. And he had made this kind of essay. And I said, like, you know, here's this manuscript of poems. It was only a manuscript that had been accepted, but it wasn't out yet. Is there anything here that you would be interested in? And he came back with three. So there's two more films about that same length after that. And what he did is that he basically, you know, had me read them into a movie camera, which he wasn't filming, but it was just that the sound was actually like the best possible sound that he had at his disposal. And then he collaged it against all this footage that he had been saving from Turner Classic Movies. It's just, you know, I couldn't have been more pleased. I mean, like, you know, when you said, you know, imagine the accursed object and that weird sci-fi light bulb thing. I mean, like, you know, I couldn't have invented that in a million years. You know? So I was very pleased, and he clearly got the sense that, you know, the book is set in this kind of twilight world between this world and some other world, some next world, whatever that would be. And I, you know, he renders that, I think, through the static sometimes, but also, you know, through the the various other things that are collage and some of the images themselves. And it's a very noirish book, and he obviously went for some kind of noirish footage too, like the woman coming down the stairs and things like that. And I love the couple at the beach that keeps coming to, like, it's like they're watching all this stuff kind of go on, you know, and either adoring it or horrified or oblivious to it. Yeah, but there was no script, I mean.
Can you talk a little bit about your process when you're approaching or going to create a poem? Some of them seem to be, you know, on the narrative side, like some of James Tate's poems, mm-hmm. to then some of the more where there's these obscure references that, you know, you have to be fairly literary to get, and it's kind of the puzzle of finding what the poet was after. So when you're approaching, how do you decide which direction you want to go to, just play around?
Well, it's not the same with every poem, first of all. Some of them are more narrative, and in terms of those allusions, I try never to write a poem that depends upon you getting something, you know, I mean, like, I think that's one of the differences between us and, like, modernist writers, I mean, in some ways. I mean, like, you know, if you're reading Pound's Cantos and you get an allusion, you know more about the poem than you did before. And again, since I'm kind of going for seamlessness, I just wanted to kind of work on the surface, and if you notice that something else is going on, that's fine. And because more often than not, it's really just bits of language that I really like that are kind of ripped out of some other context. So a lot of the ways that I write poems is to take, you know, is to kind of make notes in a notebook. And some of the things I write down, I write. You know, I write at that very minute. And then other things are like phrases from, you know, from overheard conversations or from books that I'm reading or movies that I'm watching and things like that. And then eventually some of them anyways, kind of start coalescing, almost like, you know, like kind of iron filings on those faces that you played with as a kid, you know, something like that, you know, and then suddenly there's a kind of poem there. And then some of the others, I mean, I really kind of just start out and I have a sense of what I want it to be. And with the ones that are derived from notes, sometimes there's a feeling that the poem is kind of hovering there, but it's missing, you know, it's missing things. So lots of ways, but I mean, but more and more I find that I kind of rely on notebooks and less and less just kind of sitting down with a kind of blank piece of paper. I mean, I usually have a pile of other things.
I'm curious what your religious background was and whether the language and imagery occurs. Did you perceive it occurring throughout all your work, or is it mostly specific to Hollywood and God?
It was mostly specific to Hollywood and God. I mean, I was raised Catholic, you know, surprise. I mean, it's like, you know, I don't, I mean, it's a series of languages and rituals that I feel really stamp me and that I'm still really interested in. I don't necessarily really believe in anything. I mean, my religion is really more like what I said. I mean, that it's some, you know, very primitive kind of superstition about the relationship between the living and the dead in some way. And it seems to me that when you open up, you know, a poem by Andrew Marvel, there's a kind of way in which this dead person's voice is in your head for the length of time that you're reading that, you know, and that there's certainly a spiritual dimension to that, you know. And then in that Sister Elvis poem, what I was interested in was bumping up phrases, that are in her voice, this kind of more narrative thing, having those bump up against collage quotations from television preachers, which is mostly what those were, you know, I mean, but, you know, the preachers were talking about God, not talking about, you know, Elvis Presley the way that she is, and a lot of them actually come from Jimmy Swaggart, who, you know, who's Jerry Lee Lewis's cousin, so there was a kind of rock and roll element to it.
That's one of the ones Mike doesn't win.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
And how it almost feels like a staccato fluidity to it. Is part of that a statement on contemporary society? I mean, that piece with war and the art and the makeup of the museum really sounds to be like the coming together of all of those contemporary forces.
I hadn't thought of that essay in connection with these. I mean, but in prose, more often than not, I'm really interested in concision, like, you know, taking things out rather than putting things in. And I think as a result, things can move very fast, sometimes maybe too fast. But a statement about society, I mean, yeah, I mean, I was really interested in what happens, you know, in Hollywood and God with, you know, this incredibly interesting and noble impulse in American culture towards transcendence that you kind of see in these sermons from the, you know, the 18th century, you see all through 19th century literature, and then somehow it ends up kind of in, you know, in celebrity culture and reality TV shows. But, you know, what happens when that impulse comes aground in a way in these things? And so it's not as if the impulse is trivial in any way, you know? And so how do you then deal with these, you know, kind of cultural situations that unless you kind of look at them a bit more askew, seem nothing if not trivial? Yeah, so it is exploring a social thing, but exploring it through collage in a way that I don't think determines the outcome, you know, determines an opinion about it. Because in a way, like, the impulse seems so grand to me and noble that you could almost separate it from its individual manifestations in the 21st century.
Anyone else? Will you sign a... Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
One of the things that you say you work from notes and things that happen in your life and you jot it down.
Yeah.
And then you come back to it. And how does that coalesce? Do you know where it's starting and where it's ending, or is it just something inside you that just happens?
At some point, I start typing them up. You know, I mean, I go back through notebooks and kind of type up 5 or 6 pages of, you know, and a lot of the notes that I'm talking about are in stanzas in some ways. I mean, I'll write stanzas or, you know, couplets or some version of something that, if you were flipping through the notebook quickly, you would know that it was different from some of the other stuff around it. And then when I start typing them up and start moving things around, and then often I'll have a lot, the kind of large idea for something or a title, and then not necessarily all the pieces of it. And then that's when you kind of write the pieces in between the pieces that you do have.
So when you have your title, do you know how it's going to end, or?
No, not necessarily, yeah. I mean, and I don't know the order, and then sometimes I don't necessarily know whether it's going to end up in this poem or that poem, you know. But they're a little free floating. But that was maybe a consequence of writing a book, you know, like Hollywood and God, in which most of the poems in it revolve around that, so that you could actually move things from one to another in a way that I might not be able to do in another project.
Kind of a question that goes to your film poetry experiment here. Given that we're getting, that so much of writing is becoming electronic, do you see this as the poetry of the future, where you would buy an electronic book that is simultaneously written in visual?
Well, some books. I mean, I think what's exciting about what's going on now is that there's there's like no reason for a book to have any particular form. I mean, there are, you know, there are some books that you want to stay exactly the way that, you know, they are now. They look, you know, they kind of look like this. But like you mentioned that Dada article. I mean, one of the things I've noticed is that whenever I write about art and it appears online rather than in print, I'm much happier with the results because there's many more opportunities to illustrate the article than there are in most print magazines. Like most print magazines will print one or two at the most illustrations of something. But, you know, I did a piece for the Los Angeles Review of Books that was about a painter that I did a catalog essay for. It was just basically the catalog essay. And if that had, and the Los Angeles Review of Books is entirely online. And they were able, I think, to run about 13 paintings or something, you know, and some of them ran embedded in the article and some were run as links from it. I mean, I can't think of any magazine, like you couldn't do that at Art Forum or Art in America. And the opportunities, if you're writing about music, to do something like that. And, you know, because you can illustrate through sampling. And so, like, if you were doing, a book that was about filmmakers, for instance, I mean, you could actually quote scenes from movies now in a way that you would have to suggest that through just simply a still. In terms of creative work, poems and novels, I mean, I think that what everybody's waiting for is somebody, some real genius to kind of come along and do something that just simply isn't translating, you know, the medium of books into a digital realm, but is actually, you know, taking advantage of the digital realm. Where I think it's at right now is that, like, if you look at early movies of, you know, from say 1910, you know, a lot of what people did was just kind of either film a play or park a camera like in Union Square and film people that went by, and then all of a sudden people thought, you know, I can edit the film, I can make cuts, I can, you know, I can organize shots. I mean, they were taking advantage of the medium in the way that, but it took about 20, 30 years really for that to happen. It really didn't happen until the early 20s and 30s. And I think that's kind of where we are with digital technology. Most of what you see online, however interesting it is really just somebody taking something that was conceived for books, linear, you know, a more linear culture, and moving it in, no matter what, how graphically interesting it is. But I think, so, you know, I think it's obviously somebody's going to come along, and, you know, who's been thinking about this probably since he or she was 5 years old, and really do it, you know, the way that, you know, that somebody like, you know, Murnau did, you know, in the 20s with movie, the last 20.
Will you sign some books?
I'd be happy to, yeah.
All right.
Well, thank you very much.